Risa Horowitz is a dear friend of mine, I can say. An artist whom I exhibited the first time in Australia, in Adelaide, in 2008. Introduced by another artist, art historian, Igor Holubitsky, and we sort of, it was a big gamble. I didn't know anything about Risa then. I invited her. She did send me the materials and all of that. I thought it was interesting, but then the artwork was really successful in Adelaide. It was called Trio. Probably many of you have seen it or have heard about it. So what struck me about that work then was that Risa was such a hard worker that she was trying to learn these musical instruments via hard labor. So with the system of trying and failing, she was perfecting herself. And it was really interesting how she presented the entire project at the Gallery of the Experimental Art Foundation. That when I came to Canada, I was thinking, well, let's reconnect with Risa and let's see what she's doing. And then we started talking about the project she had currently started or was thinking of doing, which is Imaging Saturn. Project will be actually presented here in 2016 at the Platform Gallery downstairs in February, I think, right?
Yeah.
It's a project she's been thinking about contemplating for a long time. You have received also the shirk?
Not the shirk. No, I might. Wish me luck. I know in the next few weeks. A media arts grant from the Kinetic Council so far.
So then at some point we thought that it was important that Risa would actually come here to Winnipeg and work on the project. So therefore this residency of a whole month of May where Risa is here with her two assistants. And it was really interesting to discuss many aspects of Saturn of which I wasn't aware. from what I saw, Risa also knows the community in Winnipeg very well, so she was able to work with Ascent Works, work with Erica Lincoln, look at the planets with Ken Gregory, etc., etc. So this kind of inner workings of a city will somehow also influence maybe the project Imaging Saturn. I think Risa can tell you everything else.
Thanks, Molly. Thanks for coming. This is very weird. I don't think I've ever given an artist talk to a room full of people I know, which is really odd. So I want to thank VideoPool I don't want to thank Malenti in particular, because how it really happened was, hey, Malenti, I'm writing this shirt grant, and I have this new project, and it's about photographing Saturn, and can I, like, have a workshop at Video Pool or something? And we very quickly engaged in discussion and longer term planning. So I've been very happy to take over this space for the past month, and I've been super productive. So thanks to Malenti and to Video Pool and to Allison and to Andy and to Rick and to all the people in Winnipeg who've helped so far with the project, including Erica and Andrew Milne, who's been really helpful, and Kelly from AscentWorks, and lots of other people from AscentWorks as well. If you don't know my practice, I prepared some samples of past works to show you, but I work conceptually. I tend to engage in projects that have a lot to do with endurance and collections and time, the durational. I use a lot of different media, but I'm really grounded, and I always tend to come back to the photographic. That's where my most focused studies in the visual arts have been. So I'll start with this piece that I showed here in Winnipeg as part of the Young Winnipeg, the YWA Young Winnipeg Artists Show that Cliff Eland here and Carol curated, I think it was 2003. At Plague, and it was really great to be involved in that show. It's my dictionary project. I was invited by Steve Heimbecker, who's a sound-based artist currently in Montreal. He's from Saskatchewan. He curated a project where he invited visual artists who had never worked with sound before to participate in learning how to do some audio editing and then do an audio compilation. This was that Video Vérité in Saskatoon in like 2000 or 2001. And I used a piece, a text list that I had created to create this audio piece, and I fell in love with the sound of, or the image of the sounds of my voice, or the idea of the amplitude waveform, and it being representative of language. So what I ended up doing was recording the entire Canadian Oxford English Dictionary to audio. And then I individuated each of the sound files, and I individuated each of the image files of the waveforms, and reprinted the dictionary. Reprinted the dictionary in amplitude waveform. So I'd got it. I'd gotten it in my mind that the waveforms must be better or more accurate communicators of thought. I've always had a difficult relationship with communication, or maybe with feeling understood. I wanted to find a way to be or feel better understood. And because the waveform is like a measurable representation of speech, which comes directly from the brain, like I got it in my mind that the waveform would be a better communicator. Of course, it was totally faulty logic. They're completely illegible. Nonetheless, I did it. I ended up producing, there was a 22 and a half hour long continuous recording of my voice reading all of those words consecutively, and that would play ambiently in the dictionary. And then I printed and bound, or had bound, these 138 hardcover books, each with unique pages. So a plug-in, there were 26 tables, one for each letter of the alphabet. S had many, there were 16 books for S, and X was this little tiny book. And I also created a searchable database, on a web server, so users could type in words and call up those words, the sounds of those words, using the MySQL database through I guess it was Netscape Navigator at that time. One of the things I really liked about the database was the way, I've never been able to tell this story in Winnipeg, people would type in a word and then another word, and then they'd start typing in poetry or song lyrics or making me say things. Some people would look for their names, so like Noam Gonick tried, because I had the MySQL database and the web browser history, I could see what people were searching for, so Noam, I think, tried 10 variations of his name and didn't come up with G-N-O-M-E. he just didn't make the association, so it was really funny to see what people were typing in. Anyway, so that was one big project, and that took place at the Banff Centre and here with Video Pool's help. I think 2 weeks before the exhibition, I realized that I had output all of the audio files, Liz remembers this, and it didn't have the correct header and footer information for consecutive web streaming. So I took all three AceArt computers home, Rick handed me a disk of Media Cleaner or something, and I had to reprocess all of those files. Anyway, it was fun. So a project that I thought about, that I'd started thinking about while I was still in Winnipeg, was TRIO, that Malenti described. I wanted to teach myself how to play this Franz Schubert piece that I had heard originally in the movie called The Hunger with Catherine Deneuve and David Bowie. It's this beautiful piece of music, and I'd only had like 2 years of childhood piano lessons, and I'd never played the violin or the cello. So anyway, one day I decided I would do it, and that it was going to be a multi-channel video installation. I recorded hours and hours and hours of my learning over 7 weeks in one of the music huts at the Banff Center, and then compiled that into about a one-hour video piece. And then I went into the Ralston Recital Hall, and I recorded continuous takes, and then brought them together using three media players that were synchronized. So I have a sample, a little dock cut, all in one, a single channel dock cut. We have to deal with turning these on and off because of that. something about perfection a few minutes ago, and I knew that I could never, ever play the song that well. And I didn't try. I just tried my best to play it as well as I could. And all the while surrounded by musicians at the BAMP Center and I forget the name of the people who make violins and repair violins. And I was really insecure about taking up this musical project. You know, the way we, you know how we treat, you know, Sunday painters? We're really snobby about hobbyists. But the musicians there were like, yeah, right on, go for it. They were really excited about it and encouraging. And it taught me something about when one ought to feel threatened or not, when I shouldn't feel threatened. One of the best compliments I got was that it reminded this guy of, you know, his child's first performance, because when I was working on the project, I felt that, I guess, earnest, even though earnestness can sometimes be boring. This was also really the first project that that I did where I became aware of those distinctions or binaries between the expert and the amateur. My goal wasn't to become a proficient musician or to create a great, you know, to perform a great piece of music, but to create an interesting video installation. I was interested in ideals of virtuosity and about competence and specialization. I guess this project led to like the past 8 years of thinking about the expert and the amateur and those sorts of binaries. And now that I've sort of joined the university where those questions of expertise and hierarchies of knowledge are much more, the economy of those things are much more obvious to me. I'm that much more involved in questioning those binaries. So anyway, I'll get back to that. But another project that I did that began to question expertise. This is Trees of Canada. It was my first solo painting exhibition. Cliff Eland taught me how to paint.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, and how that happened was on the fifth floor of that old building, he said, here's a piece of canvas, and here's brush, and here's some black paint, and here's some white paint, and blend it. He just like we spent a couple of hours in his studio, and he was like, keep working on it. Just blend. So I had been working at an architecture firm and became fascinated with the way that the architects would use the tree stamps in CAD and the way their renderings and their plans would always include landscaping. So I started investigating the Trees of Canada, and I ended up making these monochrome acrylic paintings on 300 gram BFK on rag paper. And I did 150 of them that constitute all of the naturalized and indigenous trees from the 2000. I think 2 or 3 National Forestry Index. again, I fell for this idea of the collection. It was a complete collection of a thing, a lexicon. One of the things I like about this project is that from a certain distance, they look like screen prints. They could easily have been made as screen prints. But when you get closer, you can see the brush strokes and you can see the medium itself. So again, more projects to do with typification and iconography or you know, abstraction of those things. Here's an installation at MKG Gallery in Toronto. We just put them up with pins. There are 32 conifers and 118 deciduous. I made a couple of larger canvas pieces. And while I was at Ascentworks, I made some laser cut trees. I think they're very beautiful. So if you want to look at those later, I can show them to you. And then the last big sort of duration or endurance and collection project I did, you know, like where the Trees of Canada were paintings that look like screen prints, these are like photographs that are kind of painterly. There's a really long backstory, but the short version was when I left Saskatoon in 2001, I had all this film and my camera, and I wanted to take pictures while driving, and after attempting to focus while driving, and meter while driving, I was gonna kill myself or someone, so I pulled the focus, I set the camera to program, and just started snapping these blurry images, and they were really nice. So that was in 2001. And then in 2010, I took a road trip from coast to coast in both directions. from Toronto to St. John's and back, and then Toronto to Victoria and back. And I had one GoPro at one window shooting a frame every minute. I had another GoPro at the other window shooting continuous high-def footage, so I ended up with 175 continuous hours of the entire road trip. That in-gallery gets split up, so there's an eastbound and a westbound display, and the loop of that, depending on the gallery hours, can be 2 or 3 weeks long. It just runs continuously. And I shot about 20,000 stills. And I used Adobe Bridge to start looking through all of them and using labels and tags to cross-reference and to narrow down a selection. I guess one of the things I like about this project is sort of the guilty pleasure of being a conceptual artist making beautiful images and making beautiful images without looking. I like that. I photographed, so here's just the 25 that I selected compressed west to east. That was from the westbound journey. And this is from the eastbound journey. And then I think I photographed almost all of the overpasses in the country. I don't know why I was so fascinated with them, but this is sort of evidence of engineering and infrastructure everywhere. So I included a top row. And here are some of the beautiful stills from the videos. Those GoPros are super wide angle. Just fabulous. So some of you came to the show at the AGSM a couple of years ago, where these were shown before I repaired the bad mounting job because I was really broke and couldn't afford to mount them properly. Anyway, now. This was last year, Labor Day. And I show this picture because this project makes me so happy. And this picture sort of encapsulates that for me. I am constantly excited and amazed through this project. It's involved my becoming involved with a huge national amateur and international amateur astronomy community and making great friends. I've gotten camping gear for the first time in 25 years. I've spent more time outdoors than I have since I was a child. And I guess I also want to say that we often, when we give artist talks, we tend to talk about our finished works. This project isn't going to be finished until 2040. it's based on the length of Saturn's orbit around the sun, which is 29 and a half years, and the project started in 2011. So the project's sort of new for me because each year I end up finishing some work, some photographs each year. I photograph the planet, I've made drawings of the planet, I'm working on all sorts of different visual elements and now kinetic models. Within the bigger project, there are smaller bodies of work. But as a long project, it's going to be unfinished for a really long time. And this raises Ankara for me. I've always really loved Ankara's works and his attitude. And there's something really moving to me about his date paintings. He started them, I think, 50 years ago or more. And he doesn't make a painting every day, but if you don't know the work, he makes a painting of the date on the day which the painting is made, and if it's not finished by midnight, it's destroyed. And he's been doing this for decades and decades. In the first decade and a half, he would include newspaper clippings, and he always included a caption with the image, and then he stopped. He stopped in 1969, and I think for 30 years he didn't include a caption, and then when he included another caption many years later, it was to view the world with cosmic consciousness. And I thought that made perfect sense. But I wrote a review of his work when it was at the power plant for border crossings, and I asked, what compels an artist to devise a set of mostly daily tasks to be repeated for most of his life? Never mind the fact that this is what people do. We feed ourselves, wash the dishes, go to work on time, care for ourselves and those around us. How is it different when an artist rejects the so embraced luxury of exploration, experimentation, and creation of the new in favor of systems, structures, habits, and routines? So while imaging Saturn isn't the same sort of repetition, you know, the constancy of the planet is giving me really great opportunity to experiment and explore, to make new works with all sorts of things, more than I have probably previously with different approaches to making art. It does have that element of endurance and duration that I find so beautiful in his works. I will be almost 70 when the project's done. So anyway, back to me being happy. I have stories. So I did my PhD, and the night of my comprehensive examination, which involved an exhibition on campus at York University, a friend of mine who I know through the Scrabble community, who's also a science journalist, said, "Hey, Risa, it's Wednesday, and it's almost 9 p.m., and the observatory is open for public drop-in. Want to go?" So a bunch of us went up to the telescope, and we looked at the moon, and I was like, "Oh, cool, the moon." And then we looked at a globular cluster, and I was like, "Okay, cool, a globular cluster." And then we looked at Saturn, and in the eyepiece, you know, you see pure black with this tiny, tiny, beautiful, pure white planet with the rings just barely offset. It was 2010, so the rings were almost dead on. It looked like a schematic. It was just so contrasty, but it changed something for me. It blew my mind. And I had this feeling like, okay, like it's real. It's out there. And it's so far away, but cosmologically speaking, it's really nearby. So it put something impossibly into perspective for me. But as I said, I decided, okay, I'm going to take a picture for each year of its orbit, and then I found out that it was about 30 years. I'm just reading notes now to figure out what I want to say. I like how through the project I'm really crossing the boundaries of just, I'm doing visual and media arts, I'm doing art and science. In the astronomy community, professional astronomers don't tend to observe the night sky. Everything is mediated through data that's collected through computers. And those computer programs are written by computer scientists, right? So most of the visual observation that takes place is done by amateur astronomers, yet amateur astronomers can still make contributions to knowledge of the universe. There's a guy who is a mechanic in Saskatchewan who discovered a comet, and it's now named after him. It's Comet Petrew. So amateurs in the astronomy world are often published alongside professionals when they make original contributions to knowledge, and that's a very interesting collapsing of the divisions between the expert and the amateur that I don't think is often found in other areas, in other disciplines. I like how sometimes the activities that I engage in, which we could also call practices or which we could also call methods, sometimes they're indistinguishable. So sometimes a weekend spent camping is a form of dissemination of artistic knowledge, right? Because I'm out there camping and observing with astronomers, people who wouldn't necessarily be exposed or expose themselves to contemporary art. Or when the creation of drawings is both a creative and a research endeavor, you know, it's helping me to understand what the planet will look like over the course of its orbit. So all this said, the project, I'm sorry this has been up for so long, it'll pass. The project has really engaged me in like several really huge learning curves that I'll keep talking about, from the basic workings of planetary motion to how to operate a telescope like that, which is like, now that I know how to use it, it's not so complicated, but it took me a really long time to figure out how to align that thing to Polaris so that it would rotate to make up for the rotation of Earth so that, you know, it would follow stars. So anyway, this is the first image of Saturn that I shot in 2011. The method is called projection. I held my DSLR up to the eyepiece of a 14-inch telescope at the Science Center in Regina. So just held really still and snapped the picture. As you can see, it's really low res. I think that's something, I say 116 by 78 pixels from a very high res image. There's a lot of black that's missing. And I started collecting the data about the planet, its position and where it was and where I was when I photographed it. Another reason why images taken that way or shot as stills aren't very clear is because the atmosphere is always in motion, right? There's a jet stream, the stars are twinkling because our atmosphere is creating, it's a big lens that creates distortion. So what astrophotographers tend to do is shoot video at a high frame rate, as many frames as they can, and then they'll select the sharpest of the frames and stack them. You can do it manually in Photoshop, or it's a lot easier with digital imaging, or you can use a whole range of customized, specialized stacking software for astronomy. So this photograph is like the exact opposite of that photograph. This photograph was taken by attaching my DSLR directly to Canada's largest telescope at the Dunlap Observatory in Richmond Hill. That's just north of Toronto, and that used to be the research telescope for the University of Toronto. It's no longer functioning as a research scope because it's too close to the light pollution. Liz, you're so sweet. You got such a big smile on your face. Thank you. It's 22 frames stacked I don't have the number of frames in total, but from shot video. And that telescope has a 1.75 meter mirror. The thing is like a giant machine. And the equivalent focal length in camera speak is 33,000 millimeters. It's a giant camera, or a giant lens. So for 2013, I prepared something for that year. And I wanted to sort of demonstrate or reveal all of the frames and how unclear the frames are individually, and then what they look like when stacked. So they soften, and I haven't done any post-processing, so I could probably get a little bit more surface detail. But out of 841 possible frames, I went through them one at a time, and I chose 134 that were the sharpest. And for this one, I didn't use the automated software. I used Photoshop, so I layered, and I adjusted the opacity of all of those layers. You can also do some automated stacking with Photoshop if you're interested. And a lot of people in photography use stacking for focus. So if they're doing macro photography, you really only have a very shallow depth of field and a very narrow range of focus. So they'll photograph, people will photograph an object at different focal lengths and then focal stack it so that you have a larger area in focus. I mounted that 2012 image as a part of a show at the Mackenzie Art Gallery. It's a 75 foot diagonal and about 50 or 55 feet across. Very simple. I was thinking about the prairie horizons, and I was thinking about the ecliptic, or the ecliptic is the path of the sun, the apparent path of the sun, and or the path of Saturn's orbit. And what ended up happening in that space was that whole area where the two lines intersected ended up becoming really void. So when I sat there, the wall disappeared. It became this empty, weird space that I couldn't have projected. Usually I finish work before I show it. And this work, I had an idea and it was installed in the moment. Like, I had no idea how to put up vinyl that big. And I had no idea if it would look good, because I've never worked at that scale. It's such a simple piece, but it freaked me out. And then last year I made a series of 29 drawings. I have some closer up images of it. And I enlarged the 2011 and 2012 images and put this really matte laminate on top. So they were really dead black, like no reflection at all. And that was really nice. And so the reason why I made the drawings was because I really felt like I needed to learn. Like, I needed to know what the planet would look like over the course of the project, and I had no idea what it would look like or where it would be positioned in relation to the horizon. So I used planetarium software. There's a software program called Sky Safari. There's a free version, there are pro versions. You can get it for your iPhone or your iPad or your laptops, and you can look up like any date at any time from any location on Earth, any object in the sky. The databases are uploaded regularly. I basically used a light table to trace these drawings. I never learned how to draw. I guess I should say that my training in visual arts was unusual in that the only studio courses I ever took were photography. I took some music, I took some creative writing, but I never took a drawing course or a painting course or a sculpture course or a ceramics course or a printmaking course. So I really, I had to ask my colleague Lisa Streifler to help me learn how to draw. She gave me a list of materials and said, okay, now mush them around and smudge them and see what they do and then pick. So you can see them. Good. Good projector. Thank you. So there are three views of Saturn. One that shows its ring angle to Earth. This is Earth's horizon, and down is north. so that if you were to lift this above your head on the particular date that I chose, everything inside the circle is what you could see in the night sky, if you could see from horizon to horizon. And then this is just a small detail. When each year Saturn has an apparent retrograde motion, so as it's moving, you can see it day to day moving across the sky, and then it looks like it's moving backwards. This happens because when Earth overtakes Saturn as we're going around the Sun, it's really neat. It caused some trouble 400 years ago and more. But what happened was that Saturn and the Sun ended up in the same place. I didn't know this, but they ended up in the same place. But what did change was the Milky Way. So that's our galaxy. And I have an animated GIF of that. It's not a well-done animated GIF. Click. Yeah. So this is what amazed me, is that what the Milky Way looks like from our point of view on the date each year, it opens up and it closes. I thought that was really beautiful. Yeah. Pretty good for someone who doesn't know how to draw, I think. So, I had this idea to make a kinetic model of the planet, again, to help me understand what it would look like, and to use this model to collect images and to make animations and to collect video. And I realized that I wasn't just making an object to collect images from, but it was like an object that could be an art thing. So I applied for a grant and I got it. Now I have to learn how to make it, which is really hard for me to do because I don't know how to build things or make things. And anyway, the history of astronomical observing and simulation devices is really long. Like, these are examples of astrolabes and armillary spheres. This sort of sphere was invented by Eratosthenes, according to Wikipedia, as a model. And the astrolabe is a device that's used to measure inclines, right? You could locate the position of celestial objects. I have no idea how either of these would be put into actual use. Probably it would be as hard for me as learning how to pull or align my telescope. But basically, I've spent the better part of the past year trying to learn the Arduino. Does anyone not know what the Arduino is? The Arduino is it's a mini computer. It's a microcontroller, a microprocessor that is used by not only artists, by many people, in a lot of do-it-yourself projects, and you can use it with some easily accessible code to light things up, or to use sensors to trigger anything, or to control sound or motion. So I'm learning about motors, I'm learning about programming. These are the first boards so I'm like learning to read schematics and put wire up boards. These were the first that, so Jeremy Ligui over there, he's a graduate student at the University of Regina, and I'm very lucky that I have him to work with, because we've been learning Arduino together. It was his idea to stick the little picture of Saturn on the pancake motor and on the stepper motor, but I was thrilled with myself. Like, I learned how to solder, and I put this board together, reading the schematic from that driver chip, and like, I didn't need help, I just did it. It was a huge breakthrough for me. I think this is a clickable video. Let's see what happens. I was pretty thrilled with myself because I hacked a lampshade and I attached it to the stepper motor and it spun. It spun. Oh yeah. I don't have controls. It'll just go. It'll go. Oh yeah. And then we spent, some weeks trying to figure out how to draw the constellations. You know, the sun appears to go this way, and all the planets appear to follow the same path, and all of the constellations of the zodiac follow the same swatch of sky. So this is a very rough, there's a nice caster used in place of Saturn. I was just tickled pink with myself, and it's such basic stuff, right? For someone who knows how to do this sort of thing. So anyway, this is how we've tended to be working. Rob Cruikshank was here earlier in the month. I've been able to hire him. He's a friend, he's an artist, he's a skateboarder, he's a hacker, and he's an amateur astronomer, a longtime amateur astronomer. And he,
Scrabble?
And no, he doesn't really play Scrabble. He's come to Scrabble Club once, but he doesn't really play. So he and I got to know each other quite well when I was on the board of InterAccess, and he was very willing to let me hire him to help put things together. So basically I'd be like, this is what I'm thinking of, and then he'd draw something, because I can't draw either, right? And he'd say, is this? And I'm like, yeah, like that. And so there's me and Jeremy trying to sort it out. So Rob came. This is one of the really quick and dirty pieces that we worked on together. I guess I can explain it. Basically, has anyone ever seen a planisphere? It's one of those things you can turn, and it has a depiction of the night sky, and you can use it, as I describe my drawings, to see what's up there. So we adapted one of those, and basically this was just a proof of concept for a larger piece that I'm trying to imagine what it can do. So all of the signs of the all of the zodiacal constellations are there, and this is a fake Saturn. And so the stepper is finding its zero position using a magnet and a Hall sensor, and then it's just moving itself rotationally to the start of each of the constellations. So it'll go around, and then the stepper or the servo is just controlling. So I'm just basically trying to learn how these motions relate to one another, so that I can conceive of what the objects will be. That's it. This is as far as we've gotten, and I mean, hopefully I'll be able to produce something interesting for one of the kinetic models and be able to start using cameras to capture images from those. But you know, it's a long-term project. So we've done this, and then instead of those rough and dirty drawings, I decided, okay, well, you know, I have coordinates for all of the positions of all of the stars in the sky using the planetarium software. I don't have to observe the night sky for 50 years like Tycho Brahe did. And, well, I know that it's 360 degrees, and I just plot it. So these are all based on those plottings. That curved line is a flattened projection of the apparent path of the sun with all of those zodiacal constellations. And these figures, you may or may not be familiar with some of them. There are internationally agreed upon boundaries for all of the constellations, but there aren't internationally agreed upon lines for them. So this one's called the teapot. It's an asterism in Sagittarius, and the drawings that I'm using here were made by the same guy who did the Curious George series. His name is Jay Ray, and he's made a fabulous book, a version for children and a version for adults, called The Stars, and he redrew all of the constellations so that they look like what they are. So the Virgin, can you see her lying there, waiting, ready?
Oh yeah.
You know, and the scorpion looks like a scorpion, and Libra looks like scales, right?
So before he did that, were they set up sort of to look like they were? Was it sort of his own sort of invention, or was it?
Well, yeah. I mean, these drawings. Some of them are. I didn't actually produce. I don't have drawings available of what other versions are like, but. There are Western versions and there are non-Western versions. I haven't looked into non-Western versions, but some of them look like this. But the archer doesn't look like an archer, and the water bearer doesn't look like a water bearer. I would say look it up. He's using all the stars that are within the boundaries that are possible to use. He's not making up any shapes. He's just redrawn the lines so that they look more like what we're calling them. So I used Illustrator, and the reason why I went through the process of plotting these all out is because I would like the models, like the kinetic sculptures that I make, to have this backdrop of imagery with a model of the planet in motion so that I can see what Saturn looks like over the course of its time, because Saturn, over the course of its orbit, will pass through all of these constellations in its 30 years. This year, it's in, is it in Libra this year? Virgo? It's in Libra this year, right? So over the course of the year, we'll see it pass through those scales. So, Malenti and I were talking about the difference between, you know, being a great technician or a great scientist and a great artist and making bad science and bad art.
Yeah.
So one of the things, I mean, I can't just imagine something and do it. I feel it, like, in order for me to make the work, I need to gain a certain proficiency in understanding the sky, how to read it, how to look at it. The Arduino, I mean, I'm at my limit. I don't know if I can learn much more about how to do these things, but I need to be a part of this so that I can understand what's possible so that I can ask Rob, who's awesome, to make something in particular for me. So anyway, I do find these HA ray lines to be a bit too representational, and so I've done versions, and when the lights are on, you can see with and without the lines. And one of the things that I really like about without the lines is that for someone who doesn't know, like for someone walking into an art gallery who isn't familiar with astronomy, I find these very interesting abstractions. I don't know what they are. They look kind of like plans. They look kind of like maps. Cliff said the other day they look like architectural drawings. So I like that abstraction, whereas for people who are familiar with astronomy might recognize the figures immediately. I've spent the past week at Ascentworks, and it's just an awesome place. You pay a membership fee, you take a workshop on how to do something, and then you're surrounded by people who to varying degrees are absolutely willing to help you figure something out or troubleshoot. And I've been using their laser cutters to experiment with ways of rendering these variously. Lit a fire, turned off the machine before it ruined the whole everything. Has anyone, aside from Andrew, has anyone here, Andrew and Erica, have you ever seen a laser cutter working? Like, they're really fucking dangerous. They're really powerful and they're scary. And I stood over these machines for 3 days, afraid I was gonna burn the house down. And I'm glad I did, because when the fire actually started, it's because the air hole was disconnected, I could press stop pretty quickly. So these are very, I've individuated each of the constellations, and you can look at those. The other thing I did was I took a workshop in, I realize this is a kind of boring picture, but I took a workshop in 3D, the 3D printers. So it was a very quick SolidWorks CAD 3D software application workshop, during which time I hijacked it and said, hey, could we make Saturn? And then someone else, Randy, another member at the center, spent an hour with me preparing a different 3D rendering of Saturn, and then Erica spent several hours with me adjusting the size of those files and then outputting it to this printer. This printer is brilliant. It, you know, you send it and it lays down plaster and color and it prints 3D full color objects, like objects. they're not plastic. I've seen 3D plastic, and I don't like them. I'm okay to pass these around, but they're fragile, so just go easy. The white ones don't have any color applied to them, and the gray ones have just a, we just said make charcoal gray, and then this one, we used an image, and you can wrap an image around an object, so it looks like Saturn's surface, because there's a picture of Saturn's surface on it. It's in the wrong orientation and everything, but for like a few hours of help and then sending it out, it took like 6 hours to prep the machine, and then it took 9 hours to print these six together, and then another several hours to process and clean and finish them. It's a brilliant machine. And they photograph really beautifully. Really, really beautifully. So, just a few ideas to wrap up with. I'm
scared.
Just be gentle.
Oh,
I'm kind of a solitary worker, but because I don't know how to do any of this, I'm finding myself working more collaboratively and more closely with others. And it's challenging me in my practice to find new ways of working. I did a PhD in studio art, right? And I did it with great skepticism. We all know that nobody needs a PhD to make art. So how I dealt with that, I couldn't work a day job, so I went back to school, right? But I've been trying to find these ways to articulate amateurism, you know, as a really wonderful critical method of making art. I don't need to be a professional musician to make an interesting video art project. I don't need to be a professional astronomer to create a potentially interesting visual and media art project. But there's a good chance that one day I might see something in the sky that I hadn't seen before and call it in and have my name, you know, like Supernova Horowitz. Who knows? I don't aspire to that, but it's possible. But I'm really wary about how these domains are so rigid. We have visual art, right? We have media art. We have, all these ways of knowing and different things of knowing have become very naturalized and separated, naturalized as separate entities. And I think this is a product of high capitalism. You know, it's a way of alienating people from ways of knowing the universe, and I want to try to undermine that if I can. So I guess, I'd be interested to know what you think about these divisions between amateurism and professionalism, but I'm also interested to know if you have any thoughts about this idea of presenting works in progress. This is a first for me, you know, like not giving an artist lecture at an art opening, and what it means to start sharing the processes in a more public way of making art and learning. So anyway, that's it. Thank you.
Well, Risa, we've talked about why people in English departments want to make art and get short grants to do it.
Yeah.
And how frustrating it is that they would want to make a video game, which has happened recently.
Yeah.
And so what do you think of that? That's a kind of instance of amateurism run amok.
Yeah, but you don't have to call that art.
Yeah, I suppose.
Right? We're this big political conversation about research creation in the university and you know, whether artists who are not, there aren't any art schools anymore, right? We're artists in the university and we're not taken seriously and we don't have anything to contribute to real new knowledge because all we do is like play all day, right? It is people in departments like others, like English, who can articulate a methodological framework very eloquently and a set
right.
of research methods. I want to be self-critical about not putting up boundaries about who can be creative, for example. In the same way that, you know, there's an astronomy community that I am welcomed in. I may engage in that community, and that community is made up of amateurs and professionals, right? But my goal is not to make a contribution to astronomical knowledge. That's not my goal. I'm an artist, I make art.
You know, I guess the age of amateur science is that still, you've said that it is in many ways still operative. We often think of it as something that ended in the 18th century with amateur
yeah.
botanists and
yeah.
people like that. Yeah.
And the DIY movement, the maker movement,
right.
I mean, I'm not a part of these communities, but
right.
my friends have always been. there are a lot of people who want hands-on access to technology and who are thrilled by AscentWorks is full of people.
That's great.
Who have ideas and who might fit that vision of what we imagine of over 100 years ago, people who aren't operating by those boundaries. They're just doing and making and engaging and they're curious. And
well, to play is to discover, right? So, I mean, that's, I think, all across your age groups, you know,
mm-hmm.
I think that's the most important thing for anyone to do and, you know, to use, utilize something that wouldn't be utilized necessarily for its
yeah.
main purpose.
But when you call it play in certain circles, it's not serious.
I know.
Right? And art is not serious in certain circles.
I wonder if it has anything to do with the common goal. And I'm not very well versed in the astronomy community or astronomy at all, but
there's a common goal to know phenomena. There's a common goal to track and to map and to write down for greater knowledge, as
yeah.
you were saying. And then what is the, that's sort of like a, I wouldn't say it's a narrow goal, but it's an understood and defined goal.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe within fine arts, if we're going to talk about sort of school, we kind of blew that away when good old Duchamp showed up, right? Or maybe someone before.
That might be cynical. Cliff might be cynical also, right?
Oh, no, I'm not. I'm not cynical. No. Absolutely not. No.
I think, you know, we make because we're curious, because we're hung up on something and we want to learn something about it or pester it or engage with it somehow, and it's not
mindless. Yeah, no, but I'm wondering if what in sort of the arts, what is, how do I say this? What is communicated to the public may, or communicated in how it is, in how it exists within a school, in a maybe that doesn't have as a defined thing. I don't know. Going back to the sort of good science, good art, bad art, or that sort of stuff.
We resist those sorts of rigors, right? In the scientific world, there are very strict protocols for peer review, for publishing, you know, for duplication. Duplication is a really interesting concept because anything within the sciences needs to be verifiable. Nothing in art needs verification in those terms.
Yeah.
And I think we're accustomed to letting, you know, critics and historians and philosophers describe what art does. As artists, we're not as accustomed to describing those terms. I might be generalizing, and I expect you'll tell me if I'm speaking shit. And then, like, you know, on one, it's like, why should we? Like, we're part of a world, a community, you know, like, I want to communicate with people.
So maybe, I was wondering, maybe between yourself and Valenti, that the two of you could explain how your conversation about the good art and the bad art of science.
Valenti and I had this conversation when Rob was here, and we were deep in
the... I don't know why
you
picked on that, because...
Because it's interesting,
because, I mean, especially in new media art, it's so simple to sort of make things go whiz-bang.
Yeah.
Right, and
yeah.
It doesn't necessarily...
Yeah.
It
yeah.
falls into other things. So I'm just wondering, it'd
yeah.
be interesting to hear what you guys were talking about.
Well, I like for me, it was the very idea that 50 years ago or more, C.P. Snow spoke about these two worlds yeah, that would never meet, that there was a big rift yeah, in his text called The Two Cultures, the culture of the sciences and the culture of the humanities. And they were so wide apart that there was no appropriation from one to another. Humanity as a whole could not, like he saw that humanity as a whole could not do any progress until the two parts of it would meet, the humanities and the sciences. But I think in the past 50 years we've done a tremendous leap because like I don't see your work any different than I see the work, for example, of the exhibition Toxicity, which we had a plug in,
mm-hmm.
Which was about biotech art.
Yeah.
But, so basically it was about science and art, whereas many of the works were a collaboration between artists and scientists.
Yeah.
You do something similar. You collaborate with scientists or technicians or technologists, yeah, in order to do your work. It is about scientific concepts. It is about the science of the skies, yeah.
But he also encouraged me. He's like, I want to hear about the philosophies.
Well,
you know,
what I think is lacking, and why I like your project is that I think it has an even bigger potential than biotech arts. And mm-hmm. the reason why I'm saying this is because there is a lost knowledge, yeah? Because we, like, the humanity first learned how to read the skies.
We can't see the skies anymore, right?
Well,
our
because
cities.
Of pollution also, yeah.
yeah.
But really, we have lost the knowledge in interpreting the skies. I found this very small booklet. Actually, I was given, it was given to me by, I don't know if you do know, Hakim Bey. He's an American philosopher and writer. And the booklet is called Shower of Skies. The Shower of Stars, and it's basically it is, it conveys this kind of lost dialogues, this lost knowledge, which humanity and civilization had.
Mm-hmm.
So when I see these, I see them as an interpretative sort of a symbolism,
mm-hmm.
whereas you can read the skies, you know, even read a joke and laugh after it,
yeah.
because that's what humanity was able to do before
yeah.
the invention of writing.
Yeah.
Now we cannot do it anymore. And, you know, like sciences such as, you know, astronomy and astrology was one, right? They weren't different, like alchemy and chemistry were one. No, but really, it
yeah.
was more of a, you know, philosophy
yeah.
was holding all of the other sciences within it. Now we have become so atomized that every single part is works for itself and differently, but not for the whole. I don't know who was it that was mentioning the whole before, but that is something which we should not forget. Yeah, working for the bigger integral picture.
See, I think we had this conversation at a moment when I felt completely incompetent. Like, I am on the verge of not knowing. Like, and I don't mean this self-deprecatingly. I mean, like, I
jumping into the abyss.
I'm learning so much, and I don't understand certain ways of. I mean, I don't understand. Like, I have difficulty understanding how the Earth spins. Like, conceptually, I have logical gaps of understanding that I have to overcome. Or visually, I have gaps of understanding. When Rob 3 months ago said, "What do you want to make? How do you want? How big do you want it to be? And what do you want it to look like?" I was like, panicked because I didn't yet know. Because I have to learn. I have to learn what's going on in order to answer those questions. So when Malenti and I had this very brief conversation, I was in the throes of, like, incompetence. And, you know, the philosophical part is easier for me. And that part is very intuitive for me. And there's no rift between knowledges for me. I have an interest. I saw something, it blew my mind, and here I go. You know, that's, like, what I've done all my life, right? But now I'm learning. And
but
that's how I put it to... work.
the important thing is not to get lost, because, like,
yes,
and
so
this is the good science, and good art, bad art. Like, because these projects are very complex, and you need to engage artists, scientists,
yeah.
technicians to do them. But when you do that, after a while, you start to sort of understand your partners much better, and you appropriate from each other. So basically what happens is I've seen groups of artists and scientists that were working together. So whereas the artists would gradually, in a period of 5 to 10 years, become scientists, and the scientists would gradually become artists. Of course, they from being professionals in their own field, they are becoming amateurs in the other field. Yeah, they understand something, but they do not understand everything, and it's quite visible. But then again, you know what happens after that is. The collaboration falls apart, and they find other partners.
Yes.
Sounds familiar. Kind of jumping from something you said in your talk about, well, your first looking through the telescope and saying it's real, and how, you know, if you want to talk about philosophy and all the sort of conceptual, all the ideas of reality. But I like that.
It's a philosophical term.
The blah blah blah. Yeah, it's a high tech philosophical term. Blah blah blah.
Oh,
but the point being, it sounds like you really like for you. There's a real materiality and a desire. Like real is material.
It's a thing.
It's a thing. It's a physical. It has a physical.
I mean, I've known about Saturn for a long
yeah.
time, but it was like in my retina. Like I saw it. People will. There's a really wonderful. A tradition in amateur astronomy, people set up their telescopes and say, come on, look. So when we had a barbecue at Ken's, and it was the night of opposition, and the eve of International Astronomy Day, I hauled that thing, and I was like, come on, look. And Liz was like, woo! Like,
it's true.
You know, so
when you see those craters in the moon in real time, for some strange reason, there was that kind
different.
Of... It's really different than seeing it in a book.
Yeah.
I don't know why. It is very true.
It's so bright. And people often, like Saturn is the easiest hook for people. Like so many people get involved with astronomy because they've seen Saturn through a telescope. It's sort of like I got hooked by the easiest object in the sky. But people will literally go around and look to see. It's not, they'll say, it's a picture. people have this disbelief in what they're seeing in some odd way and have to be persuaded or convinced or like you must affirm, no, that's a real thing in real time, right there, and the light bounced off it 88 minutes ago from the sun. Like, so yeah, what you said.
That's interesting.
Yeah. I've always been very literal. I've never made something that I had that made me feel I had no clue what I was doing. Like, it was like, oh, like, I've made things where I'm like, all right, now I have to read the whole dictionary. Like, I had that experience with the Dictionary Project when I was like, when I finally realized what the entire lexicon needed to be and how big it needed to be a lexicon. I was exhausted by the thought of it, but it was the project and I did it. And when I set out to learn trio, I knew that I would have all sorts of failings and shortcomings, but I could do it. I knew that I could do it as best I could. Like, I knew that I could do it. There was not some, what's that thing, neurological inhibition for me to be able to play those instruments. Whereas there are things that I'm learning that are, like I said, like I'm not a Scrabble expert because my brain doesn't think mathematically. Like, I have, there are certain challenges that I have, and it's not that I want to overcome them, it's that, I don't know what I'm saying, but
so
I've never done something that I didn't know how to do like this before.
So 29 years from now, when Saturn is, you know, finished, it's whatever, will you be finished? Will you feel like you're finished? I mean, because it's
only 79.
Yeah.
It'll be hard for me to carry a 100-pound telescope.
I know. So, I mean, for me, it becomes like stagnant. It's almost like, oh, do I have to do it?
I'm not afraid of that.
Okay.
One of the things I remember thinking years ago how I wish I could do something like Ankhawara did. Like, I love the idea, like, the day paintings. They're brilliant. And, of course, this isn't that, but I have not, since 2010, felt bored with Saturn. I'm learning so much at such a consistent rate, and it's giving me so many ideas.
Well, that goes. Sorry, I'm going to drop.
Please.
I was just going to say, it goes back to what Cliff was saying about the 19th century citizen scientist, and maybe the knowledge is there within the, you know, the pockets of science there, but talking about more of general knowledge, it's still knowledge gained by you for your own personal desires, and then but communicating, and then that comes back to the process of art, and in the sense of communication, and communicating what
and
you're fascinated by at the time.
Reciprocally, right? So this is where I'm going camping in Grasslands this coming weekend with a bunch of amateur astronomers whose professions vary, like widely. Like, the custodian in the visual arts building at the U of R is a member of my astronomy club. You know, we stop in the hallways and chat about, you know, so there's a real egalitarian spirit in that community, and they've never seen a conceptual artist before. So I get to tell, you know, like, so I'm exposing, I don't like the centrality of how I'm describing my role in this, but I'm, and here I am, and now some of you know that it takes 29.42 years for Saturn to orbit the sun, right?
It's
so there's
interesting how you're mapping stuff.
Sharing.
How you're mapping stuff and how you're visually presenting them, how you're presenting data, and how you're looking at it as an aesthetic choices you make.
Well, so was H.A. Ray, right?
Yeah.
I mean, Galileo, they all drew, right? Galileo made these. Galileo thought that the rings of Saturn were ears, right? And All of the people of the scientific revolution were making observations and sketching. You know, there's a big astronomical sketching community. They sit at their telescopes and they draw what they see. There's a real passion about observational
sketching. Which is completely different than if you're getting data from a Hubble telescope or something like that.
Oh, yeah. And I knew. For years I was downloading images from the Jet Propulsion Laboratory website and wasn't compelled to make a project out of it. I have a folder full of satellite, like radio satellite images, never compelled to make a project out of it. And then I looked at Saturn through a telescope. Like something shifting.
And they're both mediated. But one seems more, would you say one feels more real?
Well, because it's in real time.
Yeah.
There's like the light is actually hitting my eyeball from the thing. maybe. I'm not an ethnologist.
Just throwing questions.
Yeah, no, they're great. They're great.
I had a question about time in your work more generally, because this one is perhaps the most extreme example, being a 40-year project that bases itself around a day in Saturn. But when you think of sort of the traditional sort of durational artworks, they tend to be within sort of human time perspective, like an afternoon, a day, 8 hours, which is a general work shift, for example. Not a sort of the time it takes to read out loud an entire dictionary or to make slightly arbitrary sort of journeys back one way or the other, or to wait for one of the later planets to revolve completely around the sun, during which time, you may be alive or not, hopefully. I would do the one thing that it reminded me most of is the long player project.
Which?
The long player project, I think it's called, where they've programmed a John Cage piece into an organ.
Yeah.
And
is this in London?
Germany somewhere, where they played the first note takes 3 months or something.
Yeah, they waited for 3 months to see whether it worked.
Thousands of years or something.
Yes, and it's a 1,000-year piece of music. Yeah. I think it's called the Long Player Project, but I'm not 100% sure of that. So, is there a reason why you're sort of detaching from a sort of terrestrial or quotidian sort of time-based?
Well, no, but here's the thing.
Or having these sort of arbitrary boundaries, a dictionary.
Very aware now of where Saturn or Jupiter, I always knew why the moon was illuminated in a particular way, but then I started looking at it, right? And physically putting together the fact of its various illumination. And this year, not so much yet, because I'm not outside looking, but over the course of this summer, on a daily basis, I will know when Saturn is rising differently, right? Because I'll be observing more frequently in the warm weather, which I can't do all winter, and Saturn's not visible all Earth year long. Mm-hmm. It's daylight when it's visible a good portion of the year. I think I must find comfort in the constantness, on a very personal level, I think. I find I play Scrabble. I'm hyperactive. I'm a hyper person. And when I'm surrounded by people,
so reading a dictionary is probably the best thing you could do.
I was alone in the sound booth. And when I sit down and play Scrabble, right, you have chess clocks and each player has 25 minutes on the clock. And if you're playing really well, you're just focused. And I can't practice meditation, but I can sit at Scrabble really confidently and focus. So I think on a very personal level, these sorts of iterations and practices and repetitions are calming for me.
Okay.
I should probably do more aerobic exercise every day, but I don't. So.
Well, you got to carry the telescope around.
That's good enough. That's good.
10 years it'll be lighter as the technology advances.
And the camera technology will advance. 30 years ago, CCDs were and I don't know what lenses. I can physically leave the atmosphere and take my own. Yeah.
You can.
No, wait, does that work?
Well,
you launch the camera up through the strap.
I could, but then pointing it would be a whole other deal, and that's one thing at a time, please. No, but there was something I was going to say. Time, cameras,
lenses,
technology, lenses, and the technology will change, and probably by then we'll know that there's life elsewhere. We'll have activated. I'm guessing. We'll move soon. All these planets being formed.
Yay!